Hi everyone. My name is Igor Kozachkov, as I already said, and I am one of the lead developers of Advisor team. So, and I will talk to you about Advisor and the roofline model. First of all, some contacts. If you want to get your own copy of Intel Advisor, you could download it here, software.intel.com/advisor. You have to register on this site, but otherwise you could get the free standalone copy. And here is some contacts if you need any help with this. So it's general mail list, and some people on our team, you could directly ask if you have any issues or whatever. So what is an Intel Advisor? Advisor is a single node performance analysis and projection tool. It works with the MPI environment, but it collects the results per rank. So you still have to analyze a single rank results. It has a lot of features. They are chosen most important, but not all. We couldn't cover everything in a single presentation. So today we will talk about the first two, vectorization analysis and roofline. And I briefly mentioned cache simulator and map, but we'll concentrate on the first two. So, first part is vectorization. You know the compiler do auto-vectorization nowadays, and it becomes better and better over the year. But they never could do ideal vectorization by themselves. The reason is that compilers don't have the data necessary for ideal vectorization during compile time. To get the best possible vectorization, you need the profiling data, right? So this is exactly what we are doing here with Intel Advisor. The data drain vectorization allows you to adjust vectorization and help the compiler get the best results. The main view for vectorization analysis shows you some it's similar to bottom-up view in VTune, which we talked just by Paulus. And we add some additional data here. So we integrate compiler reports right here. So if you don't want to look around the compiler text reports, we have this data here right here. And we also collect some additional performance data and instrumentation-based data, such as trip counts, floating points, and vectorization efficiency. So how to get the efficient vectorization? We suggest to follow a five-step workflow. So we'll go through all of the steps. And to see how to do that. First is understanding do you have efficient vectorization or not. There is some kind of performance thermometer in the view called vectorization efficiency. So it shows you original scalar code efficiency, what you have achieved in current implementation, and upper bound, what you could get if you fully utilize the vectorization capability of SIMD instructions. Okay. Auto-vectorization, as you could see here, not always quite efficient. If you simply put pragma on PySimd, it's not always helpful. Sometimes it's even incur a slowdown. You could check traits, instruction set analysis, and other things to see why it is. Sometimes you need to run additional kind of analysis to understand that. But first thing is to check whether you have efficient vectorization or not. Vectorization not just a plain table with a list of loops of and functions and see to your source code, so you could see in the source some of the data collected by Advisor. with some time metrics, so you could quickly see which loops is where and how it's performing. The next thing is guidance, recommendation system. Advisor provide some simple advices when it sees appropriate, allowing you to get quick, but sometimes very good improvements with relatively low efforts. So you could check the performance issues column, and you see anything here, you could click it, and it will activate recommendations tab, which shows recommendations tied to particular loops. So it's not just general advices to refactor your code. It's telling exactly about the loop or function in question, and the advice applies exactly to this loop, right? So for different loops with similar structure, you could see different advices because given the data we collected, it may be beneficial to apply different optimization techniques. The next thing is trip count and flop collection. It helps us to understand why we don't have ideal vector efficiency, right? So why it is important? Because just knowing the timing of loops and its parts not always helpful. So here's an example. Here we have a loop which compiler divided in three parts, vectorized body and peel and reminder. So you see here we spend a lot of time in reminder, but it's not clear why. But if we collect trip count and call counts, we see that call count for reminder is much more than call count for vectorized body. That means that in many cases, compiler just execute reminder without actually executing vectorized part, right? So here's the problem. Besides the trip count and call counts, this collection provides also repeatable flop metrics. It's reproduced no matter on which processor do you run it, because it's based on instrumentation. So we calculate floating point operations, and by the way, you could also count for integer operations if you have code with integer operations. And time is coming from the survey, which is sampling based, but floating point operation itself are exactly counted in instrumentation instrumented collection. We also adjust floating point operation for masking instructions for AVX512, because if you use ineffectively masked operations, it could reduce your floating point per second quite a bit. The next thing is memory access pattern analysis. This kind of analysis allows you to understand how do we assess the memory, right? This is a relatively heavy collection, so it don't run on all application. You have to select which loops you are interested in. It's decrease overhead for collection. And then you could get the data about memory access patterns. So which kind of memory access patterns we could detect? Unit stride access, the ideal, when we read the memory byte per byte continuously. The next is constant stride access, when we read memory with some constant increments. And variable stride access or random access when we go into memory in different places without any order, right? So, and after detecting memory access patterns, you could see additional recommendations dealing with memory accesses, and if it's applicable for specific loops and its memory access patterns, it suggests you something to do with that to improve vectorization. Okay, the last thing is loop carrier dependency analysis. Sometimes compiler completely refuse to vectorize your code because it couldn't prove it's safe to do so. It's possible to, that it have dependencies, right? So you could check if it's actually true or not by running dependency analysis. So, and if you found there is no dependencies, probably you could vectorize your loop, okay? In this example, simply using pragma-simd for the assumed dependency loop give you almost 6x speed up. But here is a tricky question, because when you run dependency analysis, you could only prove that there is no dependencies on this particular workload. It couldn't prove that there is no dependencies at all. So you still have to use your own judgment and your knowing of the code to determine whether it's possible to vectorize or not. By the way, if you detected dependencies, so it's still not the end of the world. Because it is possible you have dependency in distant iterations. For example, if your dependency happens in 10 iterations after each other, you still could vectorize with vector length h and get the benefits of vectorization and still safe, right? But you have to check the code to understand whether this is a case or not. Any questions so far on vectorization? Okay, let's continue with roofline. Does anyone knows what the roofline model is? Someone used it already? Few people at least. Okay, then we'll let me explain what is it and how it is useful. So roofline is a plot representation of hardware limits and where your code is resides in regard of these limits. So if you plot the graph which shows first compute performance in gigaflop per second, and second so-called arithmetic intensity in flop per byte, then we could plot our hardware limits. So the horizontal line here is a peak compute limit, how much gigaflops we could reach on the hardware. And if we plot the memory bandwidth limit, it will be the slope. So in general, these roofs form kind of roof, so the term roof line. And the dots here, we could put measured floating point, number of floating point per seconds and arithmetic intensity for our code. So we could see how well we utilize our hardware. How it is useful? Well, first we could see if we are doing well. Probably we already have well optimized code, so we don't need to further optimize it. So if it's somewhere close to the roofs, probably we are doing well. Maybe we don't need to optimize it at all. And if it's somewhere in the low area, then we have a lot of room to improvements. It's worth to optimize. The second thing which we could understand from the roofline, it's how our code is bound. Basically, when we doing optimization, the dots on the graph going up, and the first roof we meet on the way is our limit. So if we hit the memory roof, then our code is memory bound. So we should invest in memory optimization probably. And if we hit the computer roof, then we compute bound, so we need to put effort in vectorization and things like that. Here is how roofline looks like in Advisor, all right? So there is a little bit more data. Let me show it in more details. So first of all, we show more roofs than just two. We show different compute roofs corresponding to scalar, vector, single point, double, single precision, double precision, FMA compute roofs, and so on. And for memory roofs, we show different cache levels bandwidth. So you could see if you hit the memory or some cache level limits. And also we have color scheme which allows you to quickly see the hotspots. So large red points is your hotspot, which you probably want to concentrate on. On the actual roofline, there is even more data, right? So it quickly starts, looks like a mess, but it's very useful if you get into it, okay? So first of all, about roof configuration. This allows you to do some kind of projection. Basically, you don't have to use roofs on your current hardware. By default, we show benchmarked roofs, so we actually run benchmarks on your current machine. So you could see what you actually in practice could reach on this particular machine. Which you could use roof configuration and enter, for example, some theoretical limits of some other hardware which you don't have at hand and see how your code will behave and which limits will be on some other hardware. Okay, so you also could quickly see how much speedup you will have when optimizing for different, for example, cache levels or different computers by looking at intercepts, which is shown near the lowest and upper roof, so called performance headroom. You could configure a roof line to show different things. In particular, for compute operations, you could choose between float and integer operation, depending on which kernel do you have. You could choose to show a roof line with call stacks. Sometimes it's important because if you have a hot loop which executes in different call chains with different characteristics, you probably want to see it as a different dots, not an aggregated one. You could choose which memory traffic to be shown, because if you show it all at the same time, it probably will be too tight filled with data to be useful. So you could choose which you are interested in more. And you also could choose which memory operations you are interested in. So you only could see read or write traffic or combined by default. Integrated roofline. This is a new thing which is added in the last major version of Intel Advisor. What is the difference with standard roofline, so-called cache-aware roofline? It actually emulates the cache hierarchy, so it not just measures the memory traffic, it tries to emulate all the cache levels and shows which cache level have how much traffic in them. And you could see it both in main view by switch by which cache level you are interested in. And you could see the same in the code analytics. You could also switch here and look for different cache traffics.
The cache level bandwidth, is there a way for it to also report the amount of memory in the different cache levels?
Yeah, of course. It's also shown the DRAM traffic as well.
Well, so like the capacity of the L1 cache and L2 cache.
Do you mean the memory traffic as all the memory reads which comes out of the CPU?
Well, so like in the example that you showed, you have mm-hmm. 21 gigabytes coming in and out of L2, but how big is L2?
It corresponds to your current machine. So it takes...
Can you just look up on the spec sheet?
Yeah. I'm not sure, probably it's shown somewhere in Coda Analytics, but yeah, it just gets the current machine cache configuration. Well, there is interesting thing because you could see cache configuration used in the command line. It's I'll show it a bit later. You could actually set the cache configuration, which is not for the current hardware, but for some other hardware, and emulate this cache. Okay. So why it's important to have integrated offline? If you just measure this single memory traffic, complete traffic, it could tell you much how it's distributed between the cache levels, because for the same amount of memory traffic, in some cases it could be mostly hit L1 cache, and in some other cases it could mostly go to the DRAM, and it will be completely different from performance standpoint cases, all right? So the integrated offline tries to show you all the traffics for all cache levels, so you could see where we spend most of the time. And the limit will be for the minimum of intercept. So the first roof we meet will be limiting factor. This is how the configuration looks like in actual roof line. So it shows what you have currently chosen and you could configure that. Basically, you could choose the integer or floating point operations in different places, including the main grid and Coda Analytics. So if you have the kernel, which is mostly doing integer operations, you could select in top to exclude occasional floating point operations, which may happen in compiled binary, to concentrate on the specifics of your kernel. Another interesting feature of the roof line is compare. So we don't have compare per se for the whole results, but for the roof line you could actually compare, and this is very useful when you're doing incremental optimizations to see how you're doing between these optimizations. So you could load another result, and it will show you two dots. Older versions and current versions, so you could see how much you improved compared to the previous version. And one more option is export feature. So basically you could export roofline chart as standalone HTML, which is easier to share with someone using your publications and so on. By the way, you could combine the views of roofline and the main grid, but you actually have to have a very good monitor to do that efficiently, right? So on the small monitors, it's maybe not so useful. A few words about call stacks. I already mentioned about this option, so you could choose a call stack in the configuration. Given that you have collected the roofline with call stacks, you could see, yes, so aggregated data is the middle one on the blank. And if you consider the same kernel in different call stacks, we could see that they have a slightly different performance. And in actual cases, it's maybe even bigger difference between them. And you could check which one you probably want to concentrate on optimizing. Exporting roofline works also on the command line. So if you're running collections and on somewhere on the cluster, right, so you could get the roofline HTML right in the command line and then view it somewhere else. To conclude, okay, so You could use a hierarchical cache aware offline or integrated offline. You need slightly different options for collections to get them. You could analyze the offline picture, choose the data you are interested in, compare the offline to measure your progress when you're doing optimization, and share results. Okay. Any questions on the offline? Yes.
So the slanted lines were all parallel to each other. Is it like a 45-degree angle?
I probably forget to say the offline is in logarithmic scale, so that is why this angle, right? But actually, this because these lines are bytes per second, right? And we have the axis in flop per byte and flop per second. So if you take byte per second, this will be exactly the slope. Do I answer your question?
So the bandwidth is gigabyte per second, so that's
right.
Like one number.
Yes.
To make a line, you need two points. Then we can make a line.
For example, this line, yes, right? This is a line, but it corresponds to single gigaflop per second, right? Fixed. And this is also fixed byte per second. It's just slope because we have choose the axis units in this way. This axis is actually flop per byte. This is flop per second. So the slope is exactly byte per second. Any other questions? Okay, just a few more words about collections versus analysis. We are talking about two analysis types, vectorization and roofline. They are not to be confused with collections, which advisor could do. For different type of analysis, you need to different set of collections, right? You actually could mix and match them as you wish, but you should be aware that the more data comes with the cost. So the more collections you are doing, the more overhead you have. So basically, survey have almost no overhead. Basic trip counts should have a relatively small overhead, about 2, maybe 4x. But if you're doing trip counts with slope and cache simulation and stack and so on, it could raise up to 10x. And if you are doing dependencies and memory access pattern analysis, it's even more. So that's why you have to choose the specific loops to decrease the overhead. So if you know which analysis you want to do, you should do minimum set of collections to reduce overheads. And then depending on what you see, you should choose and do additional collection to see more data. Guidance usually suggests which collection you have to run additionally to get something more. Okay. So any questions on any of this? For the hands-on exercise, there is a prepared stencil code example, which basically it's a finite differential method to solve. But we actually suggest to try it, to try advisor on your own code using the slides following as a rough guidance on what to do, okay? It probably will be much more interesting and because I could answer your questions and any issues you run into when doing this. So the stencil sources by itself in projects instructions advisor lab. So if you need that, and you could follow the slides, you have the presentation, so you could follow the slides on your own pace, right? Running advisor, here is the not exact exact commands to use on the NL systems, right? But you could follow the VTune guidance. VTune and Advisor both are part of Intel Parallel Studio, so if you already run a VTune, you should be fine running Advisor as well, okay? If you have any issues or questions with running Advisor, don't hesitate to ask me. So you are welcome to try it out. That's it. Any questions or whatever?
There is an equivalent website to the VTune. You just replace VTune with Advisor.
Yeah, you basically, yeah, and vice versa. If you want to get the latest copy of VTune, you could use the link I shown for Advisor, replace Advisor with VTune, and you get the same.